Good evening. Welcome to the April edition of Strapped In. I'm your host, Mike Feltenberger, and tonight we have Sportsman driver Kenny Bock, and my special co-host tonight, Eric Gambler. Thank you for being here, guys. Some events. Grandview's opener, the Bruce Rogers Moneymaker Memorial, won by Mike Guler, Brian Hurthler taking the Sportsman main. Big Diamond opener, Craig Von Doren takes the Modifieds, Logan Watt the Sportsman, and Alex Schaffstall the Roadrunners. Race of Champions at Mahoning, a first-time winner in the Race of Champions series, Jack Ely. And down at New Egypt, their opener was won by Ryan Godown. Out at Williams Grove, the All-Star Circuit, Sprint Car Circuit was sort of canceled, so some of the guys decided to invade the Williams Grove Speedway, taking the win, Zeb Wise. And at Port Royal, getting the win, Devin Borden. Big news in local racing, 5 Mile Point Speedway is on hold there. The sale has been put on hold. They will have a partial season starting next Sunday. Wow. Bloomsburg opener. Bloomsburg Fair, Rich Tobias is going to be promoting that. Their opener is Thursday, April the 20th with Speedsters, Crates, and Slingshots. Here we go. Kenny, you have followed the STSS Short Track Super Series for a few events. Is it different from your weekly exploits?
Yeah, I think the Short Track Super Series is a pretty good opportunity to kind of understand what the other competition in the other like other areas is, and try to figure out different tracks and surfaces and really like the lengths and different aspects of like learning new tracks. And learning it week to week. You gotta have a quick learning curve.
Yeah, like you go from a third mile high bank to Grandview to a big half mile and stuff down at Georgetown. Well, Georgetown's a little bit smaller now, but Delaware International and Georgetown, they're both bigger than Grandview. So is there a learning curve with that?
For sure. And especially even we traveled to Florida 2 years in a row. So like Bubba Raceway Park was like a high banked New Egypt, but like kind of different clay.
Ooh.
And then when we went to Alltech the next year, and that was like completely different from what we took notes on down at Bubba Raceway Park. So it seems like every time we go to a track with them, it's just a new thing, and we're just kind of learning as we go.
So how many different tracks did you actually go to then during? Do you ever keep count of that, or?
I don't know if I'm keeping a specific count, but last year we ran half the races with the Short Track Super Series, and the year before that we did the full year with them. Mm-hmm. We finished decent in points, but I think it was because we showed up every single week, a lot of it. But so the full series there, so I'd imagine like between the 2 years, it's been a few, couple rainouts. We've been to Steelens Grove for the icebreaker the first year, and then last year got rained out. So it's been quite a few tracks.
Do any of the tracks actually scare you? I mean, Port Royal, they say, is all speed. True.
Yeah. Well, that was actually, so I felt more at home there, honestly, because you could almost run it like Grandview. Since it's high banked, you could almost run it wide open, and it was really, really cool, really cool similarities between the two tracks. And if we wouldn't have had weights flying off and hitting our front wheel, we would have had a really good weekend there. So,
Okay, what do you got, Eric?
Well, I know you've been a Grandview regular for, what,
six or seven. Yeah.
When the news came out that it might be going bye-bye, what kind of plans were you going to put together for this coming season if Grandview wouldn't have been?
Well, I think me and my family, we've grown up there. I think that was one of the first tracks I was ever at as a child. And we didn't race anything before it. And we decided to get a race car. We've talked about in the past, and that was my first track. So to hear it was going away was really disheartening at first. But then I kind of understood like what the circumstances were and everything. And I think we always kind of held on to hope that it was still going to be here at the end of it. Like no matter what, like it's still going to be there. And even if someone had to save it or whatever, I think we were just holding out. But if they would have closed. I think that we would have tried to do like the BAPS trip,
right?
And that's an hour drive. Like, Grandview's 20 minutes down the road. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of, we were kind of in a tough spot as to what exactly we were going to do. But I think BAPS or, I mean, Fridays are tough for us. We would like, mm-hmm. I like Big Diamond, but like, I work, my mom works, my dad's retired, but it would just, it's so hard. We're coming from so many different areas.
Sure.
So I think it was that or, run the short track super series full time, which would be less races, which is something we didn't really want to do. We wanted to get, I mean, we're racing now. Saturdays forever until September. So we were trying to have a full schedule, and I think we just kind of would have picked what we would have wanted to do.
Sure.
Okay, knowing you're going to do some of the short track super series races, do you actually take team notes for the car knowing ahead of time what you got to get set up for when you get to that track?
Yeah, so like gearing and stuff like that, like the generic setups for the tracks, we've taken notes at every track we've been to and how we've changed it throughout the night. So we do have notes, but it's only a couple races of notes. So it's not like every Saturday at Grandview. I mean, that's how many races. Yeah. So, but like for the traveling series, it's definitely very helpful to take the notes and see what we can do and like changes wise throughout the night, because those tracks change way different than Grandview or way different from Georgetown. They all kind of do different stuff throughout the night. So, and not racing on it like a regular, you don't really know, like, oh, is it glazed out? Like, you got to walk out there and check it out. And if you have a chance to, like, if you get a minute in the pits working on the car, like, you kind of got to go out there and check it out.
Sure.
Yeah, because when you go to Grandview, it seems, I mean, in all the years I've gone to racing, other than Reading and a few others, very few tracks will redo that racetrack after all the qualifying is over, so you have a better surface to run at in the feature.
Yeah, I think that's one thing that I really tip my hat to Grandview about is they really make sure that a racing surface is as good as it can be all the way through the night. They don't just do it once and cross their fingers. I know a lot of places do that. We were talking about that before.
Right.
So I really like commend them for doing that because it makes it better for us. And you saw some of the tracks this weekend. Like, it's like I really like that's the first race of the year. Mm-hmm. Like, it could have been a lot worse after. I mean, no, I know we didn't have a rough winter for the clay and whatnot, but I really think it was smooth throughout the night. I mean, there's a couple hiccups here and there, but I mean, that's what happens sometimes.
Yeah, it looked like it was a little choppy over in turn one on the outside.
Mm-hmm.
And that stayed like that until Kenny came back. Well, actually, when Brad came out and watered it before the consies.
Yeah.
And once he patted it back down, it was good the rest of the night.
Yeah, I broke in the consie, but the racing surface, even in the consie after all those heat races, I mean, we had 40 cars in both classes all night, and it was... I enjoyed the racetrack as far as I got.
Okay, looks like many race teams found sponsorships, even in these hard times. Who are your sponsors, and are any of these new to racing?
I don't know if any of them are new to racing this year, but I know a couple of them have been new to racing. But my sponsors are Alarm Tech, Halter Landscaping, and Halter Materials. Burke's Fire and Water Restorations, they're new to the car this year.
I see their trucks all over the place.
They do a lot of work at my house when I had a flood. So.
Yeah, there's so many of them. Alpha Gray Properties, which that's the company I work for, which is also one of Nate Halter's businesses. He's partners with my buddy Brian Trombley. Great Bear 15-minute oil change. So they're kind of new kind of to the area. They were newer. It's right there on 100 right before the track.
Oh, okay.
And we're on board for them sponsoring us this year. And they have an open house every year. We park the car down there on a Saturday morning before the races. And so we get some people pulling in and checking the car out. It's always a spectacle to see a race car alongside of 100. ACEC Farm and Market, they're a hog farm down kind of towards Hamburg-ish area.
Okay.
Tasker's Beer Barn, I think they were new to sponsoring any race car before our car.
Wow.
It's one of my good buddies, Randy. It's his dad's business right on 422 in Exeter. Homestead Truck and Auto. That's a good friend of mine that went to school with me. JetX Transportation and T. Kohler Contractors. So that's who we have on board this year. We're always looking for more.
Now, do any of them actually come to the races, or is this?
So a couple, like, they'll have like nights where they'll get a couple guys from work together. Yeah. A lot of them are business owners that like to hang out on the weekends and just relax, you know, they're so busy. But some of them definitely come to the races and enjoy themselves every once in a while.
It's funny because sponsorship, we have this thing at Shellhammers. It's the lucky wristband concession stand voucher. And if you have a lucky wristband, we give you a $10 voucher for the concession stand. Now, two of our sponsors, well, actually most of our sponsors saw business from just sponsoring a $10 wristband voucher out in Jeep in Hamburg. They sold two cars to people that won from the wristband. And Jimbo's Gutters, they had business from people that won. So, you know, sponsorship can be very rewarding if you play the game right.
Now, do you put a whole proposal thing together when you go out?
One of my sponsors, their daughter used to run our marketing department, and now she works for David Starr in the Xfinity series. She does his marketing, but she put a package together for us 1 year, and every year we just update it and try to just of our numbers for the social media and everything on there, so it gives people like the idea of how many people see our posts and whatnot on social media too. So
that's good.
We're trying to bump up the numbers, but
yeah. Because many years ago, oh my God, I think it was Keith Prutzman that was running, and he asked me to take pictures of all the sponsors on the car. And what we did was I zoomed in, and we put the sponsor logo on the top of the picture, and we put a picture of his car down in the bottom. It was like a composite photo, but they went over really well.
Yeah.
Okay, last year there were shortages in almost everything. Are parts, tires, and fuel more accessible this year?
At least at the start of the year, as far as tires go, I think tires are definitely more accessible, maybe because they had some time to recoup their warehouses. Fuel was never really an issue for us with the crate car, but we have a new crate motor on the way from Leindecker Race Motors, but it never got to a shop. I guess they were doing trips to Georgia for late models or something before coming all the way up here, so I guess that would be our biggest hiccup right now as far as getting stuff, but we really haven't had much problems besides tires. Last year we were pretty good on parts and.
Okay, now the tires, what you run at Grandview, are they short track super series legal?
So I don't know the tire rule at Grandview, so it's like vice versa. It's the other way around. We have to have the Grandview stamp at Grandview. I think at some point when the tire shortage got kind of rough, they changed over to just make sure the compounds were the same kind of throughout the year when we were really struggling to have tires. But at Short Track Super Series, they can have any stamp as far as track goes, but they have to be the certain compounds, no higher than a 53 or on the right rear and whatnot.
Yeah, because I think Saturday night, I think I was the fullest I've seen Bayshore's trailer with tires.
They even had it in the parts trailer, too.
In like about 3 months at racing there. So it was nice.
Yeah, it was a good sight to see.
Mm-hmm. Okay, do you actually load the car up with fuel when the night starts, or you put it again as needed so you don't have that added weight for all the action on the speedway?
Well, I got the added weight right here since last year, but we usually put it in throughout the night. Like, we'll go out with the feature at like 8 or 9 gallons. Heat races, we're not too, like 6 or so. I think when we scale it, I think we have like 4, 4.5, where we try to have something around there just so we're consistent when we scale the car on a Friday or a Thursday.
Okay, now do you have individual scales for all four corners?
Yep. We have forget the name of the brand. We bought them used. But Remco, I think it is. But we have four scales, and usually Dad likes to do that. That's kind of his peace and quiet time. Because if I go down there, we'll start talking and nothing will get done sometimes when we're scaling. So.
Okay, now Brian Hertler won the opener, and it's amazing because I posted a picture on Facebook and people had to chime in about he's had 6 years in this division, you know, isn't it time to move up? Mm-hmm. But Brett Gilmore actually moved down from the modifieds to the Sportsman. Do you like the challenge of running against these guys, Kenny?
Yeah. I think last time I was here, we were talking about all the modified guys coming down the run to 38.
Yeah.
So this is a little similar subject. I like both of those guys very much, both of them. I don't mind running against tougher competitors. I don't mind even running against the modified guys at the 38er. So the unfair part doesn't, as long as our cars are the same, I don't care. It's definitely, it's almost the same reason why I like running the Short Track Super Series, is trying to get just myself better as a driver. So whoever, I know I ran a race out at BAPS one year. We put our open motor in it, put a four barrel on it, and ran it as a modified. So I was out on the track with Frank Cozy and Craig Whitmoyer and whoever else was out there that night, Joe Funk and all those guys. So I definitely am up to the stiff competition. I've got a couple under my belt this year, or this my career, so this year shouldn't be any different. And once we get our car figured out, I'm pretty excited about this year.
Well, that leads to the next question. Thank you for saying. You seem to have straightaway speed opening night, but it looked like you were having issues entering turns 1 and 3, but when you came off at 2 and 4, you were again fast. Did you seem to find a problem with the 6?
Yeah, I think we were having some kind of fuel pressure issue where in the corner it would have no power, but on the straightaways it would have great power. So I knew the motor was running pretty well for a 2.5-year-old crate motor. So we just figured it was fuel problems, and we tore the car apart, and we're still kind of going over it. It's only Tuesday, so we got a little time.
Could that just be from the way that the fuel was sloshing around?
Yeah, we were taking the fuel cell apart, making sure the baffles were in there okay, and the fuel pickup was on the right back corner, and making sure all that was good. Same with the carburetor, making sure the floats were okay. We had a little bit of that trouble in practice at Grandview, but by the third session, it cleared up and it was good. We checked the timing, and we thought the timing solved the problem, but I think, I don't know. So we just got to kind of go over everything and kind of make sure everything's perfect.
Okay, they talk about open Sportsman engines compared with the crates. Is there actually rules for open Sportsman engines?
Yeah, I mean, Grandview has a set for them. I remember at one point it was we had so many different sets of rules. It was like crate motor with aluminum wheels, or 602 with aluminum wheels, 604 with aluminum wheels, open motor with steel wheels, open motor with aluminum wheels, and it just kept getting out of hand. So we just switched to the 602 to run the Brett Deo series, the Short Track Super Series. So it just was a little easier for us not having to worry about too many of the ticky-tacky rules. It was the same rev limit for us. I know the open motors, they were thinking about changing it halfway through the year, and we just kind of said, we're just running the crate and calling it a day.
Is there a disadvantage to run the crate compared to those open motors?
I think that also depends on the night at the track. If it's like at real heavy track, the open motors definitely have a little bit of an advantage coming out of the corners, just being able to dig and getting a lot of that horsepower to the ground.
Yeah, because I had Parker Goulden on a couple years ago, and he said, once we get started, we're as fast as the opens. He says it's just that half a lap to get that crate up to speed.
Yeah, it's momentum for sure, and then on a dry slick track, a lot of times our motor's a little more torquey than theirs, so we'll be able to drive off the corner a little better on a dry slick track for the feature. So I think, especially for us at Grandview, it would be trying to get through that heat race, trying to get to the bottom with those open motor pads. Those guys can just drive. I mean, it's a huge difference. I mean, speaking of Brian Herthler, he's driven by me on the outside, and there's no outside on the track yet. I just don't am I not doing stuff right? So I think half the battle at Grandview to make the feature through the heat race. I mean, if you hit the handicap, great. I mean, but just getting through there in a crate motor is half the battle.
Okay, this is going to be a good one. Is there a roundabout way of cheating with those sail panels?
I don't know. you know, I always, the year before we started racing, I watched the Brett Gilmore, Brett Kresley battle for Sportsman points right. that one year. Yes. I think it was 2012, maybe, or whatever.
And the feud started there.
Yeah. Brett the Threat, Brett the This, Brett the That, and they all changed their names three times. I remember Brett Kresley's sails had louvers in them, and I keep, like, kind of just like, hey, Dad. Do you want to try that? Like, we always complain about the car being tight, and like that would loosen it. Like, you're not catching as much air.
It's a little air go through, doesn't it?
Yeah. And I remember John McGovern years back. The last time he raced, he won, and one sail panel. It was like one was taller than the other. I was like, what the heck's going on here? So I don't think we get our bodies built by BFP, so we just have the standard body, and we'll have the window panels for modifieds and the short track super series. So we haven't dabbled, but I always thought about it though. I always thought about those louvers and see if that helps.
Does the wings? I really never, because I personally I don't like a modified with the sail panels. I just don't. I just don't like it. Does it help in the corners?
I don't know about
when the balance of the car.
I think for us specifically, because we don't have as much horsepower as the actual small blocks right. or the big blocks. I think it really helps with how loose or tight the car can be. So your setup has to be a little different, because when you're at Georgetown and you go or somewhere and you send it into the corner and then you go to step on the gas and there's just you don't have the horsepower and the bite to really turn the car unless you get your setup just tippy top right. So I think the windows help with kind of loosening the car up and helping us turn a little bit better than having those big clunky sail panels on. But I don't mind either way, because I've seen a heck of a lot of races that on those short track super series, those modifieds, when they get ripping around a small track, it's actually kind of, it almost looks like sprint cars going around with the wings, because they're so damn fast.
Do you get anything out of the test and tune session then, Kenny, as far as, or is it basically just there to make sure you don't have anything leaking or anything that needs to be repaired or do you get any gear sensations from that? You write these notes down as you're going out?
Yeah, I don't know if we this year wrote as much down. If we would have had our new motor, I think the gearing might have been a little different, maybe a point or two here and there. But this year specifically, it was just trying to go out there and make sure everything's tight, everything's good to go. We replaced a lot of bolts on the car over the off season. It was down to a frame. It was just kind of just shaking it down. We had our old motor in, so we knew we had Old Faithful, and that's been good to us. It was really more of a make sure everything's tight and good to go.
Now, your normal season, does it end right after the sixth, or are you still running some more races down the line? And then when do you start your maintenance program for the following, for the next year?
So, in the previous years, I think we've done a good job of doing a lot of extracurriculars after the Sixer weekend. This past year, I had a wedding to go to the night of the 38er. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't race in the 38er, and we flipped at the last 38er. So I think our car owner, my mom, has had the craps of the 38er right now. Last year we didn't do much. Last year was kind of a tight budget. We wrecked a lot of stuff traveling around in the beginning of the season, and we did our Florida trip last year, so that took a lot out of us too. So I think at the end of Grandview season we were just kind of we're good.
Now, will the idea of no modified drivers allowed to run a 38er change your mom's thoughts on running it?
I don't know if it's really that's not the issue. I think it's more of newcomers coming into a slimy, greasy heat race and not knowing how to drive that track when the regulars, we know how to, you know how greasy it is sometimes those first couple heats.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
So I think it's kind of that more than anything, and people just pushing their way through because it's a big race. I mean, you know how it goes.
Oh, yeah.
So I think it's more that than the modified drivers coming down. So.
Okay, even though with the amount of laps that you do have at Grandview, when you go out for hot laps, do you like to follow anybody to see if you have the same speed as they do during the course of hot laps?
Yeah, usually Brian Herthor.
Really?
If I'm in the same one, that's usually who I'm looking for. I definitely, I know
cool.
Everyone knows the fast guys there. And I try to get out. This past week, I kind of came out late, so I got stuck on the outside trying to get into the infield, so I had to go in the first group, and we were pretty fast, but I didn't really have anyone in that one. Usually they're always parked in the back, blocking that back lane. Shout out to Mertzy.
Okay, when you're out for hot laps, Kenny, when you come in, do you have a crew chief that says you might be able to do this, or are you a hands-on driver saying, you know, you might want to make these changes before I go out for qualifying?
I think me and my dad do a good job of that. Okay. My mom helped set up the car prior to the last couple years, and she knows a good deal about, like, she's read the Bicknell book quite a few times. So we're all pretty familiar with the car, and we all kind of talk about it. Generally, it's me and my dad and talking about what happened in the last session, what the track's going to do. So, I mean, between hot laps and the heat, we don't really change too much because we know if I'm tight, the track's going to come to us,
right.
Depending on what heat we're in. If we're in the first heat, then I might try to loosen it up a little bit, because generally in the heat, like with the crate car, I'm a little bit tight in the hot laps, and then the track kind of dries out a little bit, sun starts going down, and it kind of holds a little moisture for the first couple heats. So if I'm in the third, I know I'm good. Maybe if I'm in the first, I'll try to loosen it up a little bit. So we try to talk it all through.
Do you like the fact now that we pre-stage in the pits instead of bringing yous into the infield to line yous up?
I'm so used to that going down there. So I was in the third heat this week, and I was in my car ready to go when the national anthem was playing. So I'm already kind of in that groove of being ready a race before you. Mm-hmm. And like my dad, we don't like to rush. We like to be ready. I'd rather be sitting in that lane for, I'd go down to the infield for two races. I like to be ready and not rushing around. So sometimes if we break something in the heat and have to run the Conti,
is there a disadvantage though, sitting up there, that you're not being able to sit on the track and watch what some of the guys are doing?
Yeah, that's true too. Cause I mean, in the infield, I try to look at Ray, because once your eyes get going, like your eyes almost get tired of, like you get dizzy almost because you're like, oh, they're coming out of three, going to four, or one, and then back and forth. And I just like to kind of relax myself in the infield. But in the staging lane, it is nice to see like what lane they're running, because you're kind of up a little higher. You can see them going into three. Mm-hmm. You can't really see much, especially with the head restraints and whatnot. So.
Okay, we're at the halfway point. It is our picture time, and I submitted a picture for Kenny to discuss here. So what do we got with the photo? Your 2023 racer, Kenny.
Yeah, Joe Adams did a great job.
And all your sponsors are well-versed along the sides of the race car. And the nose piece. Does that, with your name on it there, does that get tore up a lot, Kenny?
It almost, the nose piece doesn't, I try to keep my nose pretty clean. Right? but I think all that shiny aluminum gets almost sandblasted.
Okay.
Along with the right side of our car. It's almost like you took a sandblaster from like 10 feet away and just constantly did it. I mean, by the end of the year, it just is. You look at the left side and look at the right side and be like, whoa, is this the same race car?
Chassis, what do you got?
Bicknell 14.
2014?
Yeah.
Is it one of those high cage ones or?
I think it's standard. Okay. We bought it from Jordan Umbenhauer in 2015. So actually, fun fact, I got to watch that car race in the Sixer that year before I bought it. So that's kind of a cool little snippet.
What do you have for shocks?
We have Integras, we have BFP and Jason Bayshore, and whoever the guys are up there, they do a really good job of that.
Okay. The big number, where'd you get the number?
I played baseball for, I still play baseball. So I played baseball forever. And my number used to be 3, and then I joined this program called the Berkshire Red Sox, and they did exactly the same thing as the Boston Red Sox do. Mm-hmm. And there was a guy on my team that already had 3, so they just doubled my number, and that's what it was since the time I was 13 to now.
Well, when I used to work at Rawlings Sporting Goods, we had the Berkshire Red Sox come in for all their bats and gloves. And
yep.
Yeah,
I remember having the card like 10 or 20% off, and I played with them until like probably about 12 years old till I was 19 or 20.
Okay, one last thing with that picture. You see a lot of guys, Kenny, you're actually turning right to go left. Mm-hmm. A lot of guys sort of drive in now instead of, you know, doing the sort of sliding. Do you find you have more control in a car sliding than you would just, you know, taking it in?
I think you definitely want the car to do what it's supposed to do. So you definitely want it rolled over a little bit.
Okay.
In hot lap, like for that picture, that was at practice, I think.
Yep, that was hot lap.
Yeah, so the track's pretty wet and heavy, and I had a really tight car. So I think that's why I'm kind of, you can tell I'm up out of the groove. I have my left rear kind of on the cushion.
Okay.
And like for a drier track, I think I do an all right job of driving it in. But for some of those heat races, just trying to get the car turned is half the battle for that.
And do you have the full self-containment seat in there?
Yep.
So you're fully with the the Hans restraints and everything?
Yeah, Hans, arm restraints, all the whole nine.
Okay.
I always got to ask, the double hoop rails, mm-hmm. on the side, what kind of advantage do you feel you get from the double?
I think definitely, so I know Grandview lets us do the double on the left side. Mm-hmm. That's really for like someone trying to be underneath you. And if it was a single bar, it goes down,
right.
Not mm-hmm. up. I see some guys running them upside down.
Mm-hmm.
You see it higher on the top. But, my thought process behind it is so someone's right front can't get underneath you.
And get hooked in.
Well, that or unload your shocks, and then they drive by you like you're standing still.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, looking at that, can you see what is your vantage point there? Can you actually see over the hood? You pick a spot with the top of the shocks or anything, or can you actually see everything from the way you're seated?
Again, I can see my bumper, the top of my bumper from where I'm sitting.
Right.
So I sit pretty high up. I have a crash pad in my seat, so that gives us an extra inch or so of a little cushion for if you do get in a crash. They're really good seat insert. So I sit up pretty high. I can see pretty much, I can see everything. I know some of the kids these days probably need to stick a phone book under there. It's insane.
Yeah.
How much
clearance do you have from the top of your head to
Not
where
much.
Your roll?
I have changes. So we just run the, I know Grandview doesn't make us run it, but we have the foamies, like if we want to go down to Jersey and race, mm-hmm. that you have to have some kind of padding on everything that your head could come in contact
right.
with.
Okay.
So I have the air intake on the top instead of the side because it always gets caught on my full containment seat. So we have it on the top, and that's just about on the roof.
Okay.
Just about.
Yeah, because I know I always hear Ray on the radio when guys are coming out the packed track and he sees somebody that their head is like even.
Uh-huh.
He's like, yeah. He goes, Cliff, he's a little sitting a little high in his seat. So, and then I know for a fact that's what he's worried about, that his head is tied up against.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, I don't hit. If the hose is on straight, if it's on like kind of cocked up, I mm-hmm. can feel the roof like hitting on the little bit of the hose, but my helmet is... clear. I'm not on the pads, like on the cross mm-hmm. members or anything.
Yeah, because for the Salmons indoor races in New Jersey, they either like you to have a bar going across the top of the roll cage or the little halo that you can put on there mm-hmm. now. So in case you do roll, when somebody comes into you, there's something there to protect your head from getting hit.
Mm-hmm.
Kenny, do you follow any other racing series?
To race or?
No, just like watching TV or news or whatever.
I mean, we dabble in the NASCAR series a little bit. I mean, I definitely, since I share a sponsor with Xfinity Driver, I definitely like to keep up with it. we're not religious with it, watching it every Sunday or anything. Mm-hmm. But that, and I definitely like the sprint car series. Kind of local dirt. I mean, every time I was at my cousin's birthday party, she's like in high school, so I should have been there, but I was like watching short track super series at like Sealands Grove or something. So I'm definitely always watching any kind of racing I can get my hands on, or I'm there.
Okay, so with that then, on your nights off, if there's something on Flow or Dirt Vision, you're checking out and see what's going on at these?
Yeah, usually more of the, like, our type of racing, right, up in North, so Northeast Modifieds, I definitely try to do a good job of keeping up with all that and seeing who's doing well, and especially since I've raced those tracks, trying to watch and see if I can learn anything.
Yeah, you know, just take some notes, yeah, so, absolutely.
Yeah, that, and I mean, we'll watch some drag racing every once in a while with my old man. He likes that, and we were at Maple Grove last year, so.
For the National.
Yep, so that was really neat. But other than that, like, we just.
You ever been up, do you ever do Mahoning?
No, I've.
Oh my God.
Yeah, never. The short track asphalt.
The fifth mile circle.
Yeah.
Yeah, running the thimble.
They have some great racing up there, though. I gotta give them that. Any thoughts about trying the modified class full time?
So this year, we're hoping to get the Line Decker House Motor out for some Thunder on the Hill shows. Full time is always the goal, I guess. I've always like dreamed of running a modified at Grandview. Mm-hmm. I've gotten halfway there, if you will. So I think that's kind of the next step, is to just kind of just go do it.
Okay. The Thunder on the Hill shows that Bob Miller has, so you're trying to work your way into having a car ready for that?
Yeah, so we talked to Jason Leindecker, and he said we can use his house small block motor to run the Thunder on the Hill shows, and we've made arrangements to try to get out there, switch the motor out, run the same car. We don't have another chassis, so I think we're just going to have a couple busy weeks on our hands.
Now, do you have regular crew come into the garage for maintenance during the week?
Usually during the week, it's just me and my dad and my girlfriend washing panels and helping us turn wrenches, and it's really just us. But at the races, we have Mike Garrett and Dustin, his son, Dustin Garrett, and Mike Jr. But we also, on Tuesdays, we try to work on the car, and Josh Folk from ATS, he comes and helps, and he's a huge help. So if we wreck a front end, like, he'll be, Tuesday's his day, he'll come right there, and and he really helps us out while we're washing panels. He's in the garage with my dad already taking it apart, so we definitely work as a unit sometimes.
Okay, so who does the Kenny Bock track videos?
That would be Casey. My girlfriend Casey, she does an awesome job of doing those videos, and it's a fun little gig we got going on here.
Do you have a GoPro in the car to do anything with the GoPro?
Yeah, we so I've had a GoPro. I think the last time I used it, Derek Smith threw a rock at me in hot laps and broke the case. And we just had stuff going on, and it sat in the trailer, but we actually got a new case, and we're gonna be doing a little more in car and a little more interactive for people that really don't know what it's like to be in that car.
Yeah, because I always see Brett Gilmore used to have, he was doing it all last year, and I got to see a lot of his when he was doing, like, I guess it was hot laps or his heat race. He wouldn't do anything for the feature, but he would definitely have it for them. So it was pretty cool.
Yeah, Brendan Kroll did a lot of those, I think, helped him out with those, and he does insane videos. Those are really awesome. Yeah. He actually put a, for that 38er I flipped out, he put a GoPro on my car that night. He was like, hey, can I put a GoPro on? I was like, yeah, sure, go out for the heat and flip it. And I was like, hope your GoPro's all right.
Yeah, because it always gets me nervous, because I always like see when I come into turn one, how far out I'm standing. I'm like, Eric, what are you doing out that far? Move back.
Will higher gas prices change your traveling plans?
I don't think so. You know, we went down to Florida. I think that was kind of like peak COVID, and when everything kind of like the S hit the fan, for lack of a better term.
Yeah.
So I think gas prices aren't too bad for us, for it affecting us.
Right.
But I can see some it does a little bit if you get to traveling a whole heck of a lot. Like we go to Grandview every week, so that's a 30-minute drive to and from, and then if we want to, those Delaware trips are kind of what get us.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If we were traveling the entire, just traveling around no matter what, like let's say Grandview closed, I think it would have really affected how we went about racing just in general.
But that new Route 1 makes it a heck of a lot easier than when you used to take 13 and it's
that
new Route 1 is actually incredible when it comes to traveling through Delaware. Kenny, you got any superstitions?
Well, I was a baseball player, so I feel like I have a whole heck of a lot. I guess I have tons of them. It's just like little stuff like putting my shoes on one way or the other. How'd I do it last time when I did well? I look for all those little things, but once baseball season comes around, it definitely gets worse. But I like to think I'm a normal guy.
What about a good luck charm in the car or anything?
No, just as long as all the bolts are tight, that's I don't care. I'll drive anything.
Well, everybody, I mean, back in the day, I mean, I've been going to the races since 1958, and the green was always the, you know, the thing, and getting paid in $50 bills was a thing, and, you know, peanuts. But
that I'll agree with you on the peanuts. If they have shells on them, get them out of, get them off anywhere at a racetrack.
Really?
Yeah. I think the superstition is that it's like checkered pattern.
Yes.
It's like the checkered flag.
The shell.
Get them out of here. I think we went to Daytona or one racetrack, maybe Volusia, and we went to the concession stand and I saw peanuts. I was like, this is an atrocity. But we used to have green on the car too, so I the green thing. That one.
Well, Brian Hertler's making
Some
decent money with the green on his car.
Yeah, I like the green. I want to do a throwback car to our first year of racing and try to do a blue and a green sometime soon.
Cool.
But
okay, what do you think of the new upcoming talent like Logan Watt and Jesse Hertler, Bauman? You know, are they the real deal?
Some of them. Some of them, for sure. I mean, some of them are kind of little snot-nosed brats. But we're good friends with the Watts, and we think that Logan's the real deal, for sure. Jesse's the real deal. Like, he knows what he's doing.
He's getting better every week.
Oh, heck yeah. So there are a lot of the young guys that are really, they really impress me. I mean, even Adriana.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I mean, she's young. Kyle Smith, he's young, mm-hmm. like all those young guns.
Yeah.
But there are some that kind of do some things that we don't appreciate. I look forward to seeing how they can progress too, because I started so late, so it's nice seeing like kids that have been racing since they're five and being like, yo, like maybe one day I'll be watching TV and be like, I raced against that kid.
Yeah, Kyle went from the slingshot. You know? Kyle went from the slingshots to the Sportsman class, and I guess Dad Mike said they're going to give it one more year, then they're planning on moving him up.
Well, now I know there was quite a few guys that are running like some of the crate stuff that's going on like at Babs, and that didn't come to Grandview on Saturday. Do we see maybe the field getting bigger than what we had this past Saturday as the year progresses? Or do you think the car count might drop a little bit?
You know, that's a good question. I noticed a lot of like reputable names left Grandview this year, so I was a little concerned about that. But then when I got there, it was just not that they're replaced, but it's just new faces.
Mm-hmm. There's always somebody
more
to fill in.
Yep, exactly. So I don't know. Maybe it might fluctuate. Maybe some of those guys that traveled away, whether it be modifieds or sportsmen, maybe they'll venture back if they get tired of where they're at or track conditions or car counts or pay.
Dylan Hoke went 305. Is that what he's doing? He's running a sprint car?
That's probably almost an upgrade.
Yeah.
But some of those guys are just traveling.
And I know Dakota Kohler's coming back in a couple weeks.
And
I know
the Carroll went out.
Wasn't he in that big crash down there at Sealands Grove?
Yeah, I think so.
I think
yeah.
So
Well, Vaquero's racing at BAPS, I believe.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
I don't know if they're going to come back. I know they weren't too happy with the way things were going at the end of the year last year.
Yeah, we were neighbors in the pits, and we really liked them, and we were sad to see them go because they were just real good people. And, I think maybe if they get tired of getting beat up at a different track or –
I see 38 cars pretty much on a regular basis down there.
Yeah, and, especially for us.
And for that series, I think it's the toughest competition for Sportsman's around.
Yeah, I mean, I would definitely agree with you. I think that we have, we have more cars. We normally have more cars than the modifieds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Show us the money. but I definitely think that we have a really good competition of cars for our class, and I know it's like not the premier class, but there's definitely a heck of a lot of talent in that Sportsman class at Grandview, and that's why I'm glad to be back.
And the thing about it, Kenny, is there's a lot of nights during the season that the Sportsman race is actually better
than
the modified
race.
Yeah,
I agree with that.
It's hit or miss. Yeah. It's one or the other, usually.
I agree with that.
What you got, Eric?
You said you just went and you bought a car. You never started out in like any go-karts or quarter midgets or any of that kind of stuff?
No. I went to college to play baseball. Came home and we would always go to races. Mm-hmm. We would always travel to tracks. If we went on vacation, we'd always try to find a dirt track. And my dad had like a minor heart attack, mm-hmm. I think 7 or 8 years ago. So I think as a group, and my mom being the big promoter of this, I was like, why don't we buy a race car and actually race instead of going to watch the races? So I can't say no. So we bought a race car and went racing at Grandview and had our fair share of mishaps, but I think those kids that we were talking about have a huge advantage of doing something awesome with their careers because they never had that. Mm-hmm. I started when I was 20 or 21, mm-hmm. maybe 22. So, we're just trying to grow as a little team. I know it's not like it's not like we're going to NASCAR where I'm a little old. I don't quite have the hairline.
But you're having fun. That's all that matters.
And the reason we did it was to bring the family together. And
well, that's cool.
We're together all summer long.
Yeah, that's great.
Okay, we're down to 10 minutes. Here's a question I like asking. If you're leading, okay, on a restart, what makes you decide if you want to run the top or the bottom in the front row when you get to pick your spot?
It depends. I personally like the top. I feel like I can, especially if I get a good jump, getting the momentum with the crate motor, getting it around the top. It also depends on the track. Mm-hmm. If it's all right, it depends on the modifieds before us. On that race and if they used up the top or not. And it also depends on who's next to me because I'm definitely not letting Brian Hertzler take the top. So there's a lot of factors and how the car's running or, whatever.
Do you have a special game plan for the longer distance races? I mean, you're not possibly going to get to the 38er, but you have the Firecracker 40. Do you have a different game plan for them than Kenny?
I think I try to tighten that car up as much as I can take it and then let the track come to me throughout the race. If I can just put myself in a good position at the end of the race and having that track come to us and the car's getting a little looser and we're just progressing. But like I said, that's all like how much water goes down, how many laps. And I think we definitely have a different game plan, different set of tires, try to get, especially in those big races, also depends on where you're starting too.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So if you're in the front, you're going to try to stay up there all race. So coming from the back, it might be a different situation.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Depending on the track makeup, does that determine if you're going to be an offensive driver compared to a defensive driver?
I think I'm always. I think anyone can probably attest to this. You're kind of always in offense mode. It's just how risky you're willing to push the offense mode. You never really want to be racing defensive unless you're in the front and you're like losing the car or something. But I always try to be aggressive, but try to pick my battles, you know, so.
Okay, when you're running up front and you're coming up to lap traffic, when do you start to decide how you're going to go about getting around the slower cars?
Just don't think about it and do it.
Really?
I learned the hard way. I mean, you obviously see them coming up through. I think Brad Brightbill flew by me in lap traffic a couple years ago, probably at the Summer Splash when that was still a thing. Or maybe it was the Firecracker. But I came up on lap traffic, and I was in a good spot to just do it, and I didn't pull the trigger, and then all of a sudden, Brad just, like, flies by me like I'm sitting still, and I almost thought I was like a lap car at first. I was like, he's passing me that quick, but it was just like that little bit of hesitation. You just kind of, I think you just kind of be as aggressive as you can be, and make sure you just put yourself in a good position not to do anything silly.
Okay, when you're chilling in the pits or whatever, is there any driver you go to just to ask advice or just to chill out and have a relaxing time before you go back out in the speedway?
Yeah, I think me and Parker Golden have a good relationship. we always hang out and chat a little bit, but usually on race day I try to get what I need to get done and just kind of focus on what needs to be done. I mean, definitely seeing Derek Smith back in the pits and anybody that's friendly. I mean, that's the thing about racing. Everyone is just kind of big jumble family. Like, we all know someone that knows someone that.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah.
In your deal, then, it actually is a family team, then?
Yeah. My parents own the car. I race the car. We work on the car. It's it really is a family gig. And
that's cool.
I mean, even some of our sponsors are literally like family. So, yeah, it's a big family deal with Bock Racing.
Okay, we'll get this out. Was your girlfriend a race fan before you met her?
No.
now she can't get enough.
I don't think she was ever at any kind of race. So I think she went to drag races at Maple Grove for, like, rice burners or something. other than that, or truck pulls or something like that. But Rowdy Round was not in her vocabulary.
I got one for him. This is the official coming out of me here. How long do you hold grudges?
Oh. That race.
That race? Yeah. If you don't get it, make it happen.
Get it in the infield a little bit, but other than that, I don't. I mean, coming out to the next race, I'm definitely not going to give you as much room as you thought I was, but I'm not going to. Like, we're a family-owned team, so I can't risk wrecking our own car.
Sure.
So it's kind of. I mean, if I could, I would. No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. But there are times where you have to, like, cool it. And I know, I mean, I've gotten penalized because I went into the infield and gave someone a bumper to the bumper. And I don't know if it was you that told on me, but well, someone told on me.
Nope.
So,
nope,
I mean, there were times where.
We're down to 4 minutes. So, yeah, they really do the retaliation now. You got to watch what you do in the track. Man. Here is one I have to ask. Would you like to see the left side handling back to the right side?
What are you talking about?
The pan-R bar.
Yeah. So I really like the right side because you can adjust it in the car. But I definitely think with the left side, those cars really hook up pretty well. So that's kind of, I'm 50-50 on it. I really like, because that Panhard bar was, like, really good for, like, a dry slick track, and we're after the modifieds. So it's the track changes from the time we get on the track to then. They put a little water down, so it's, like, kind of tacky, and then by 5 or 10 laps in, it's dust. So it's nice to have that, like, on a caution lap where you can really crank it down or up or whatever the case is. So, but also, this car really hooks up and comes out of the corners a lot better, I find.
Okay, we're down to 3 minutes. Two good questions. Do you enjoy the meet and greets and having the fans come see you after the races are over?
I love that. That's one of the my favorite things about the sport is getting out there. And I was that kid wanting the hero card and wanting to sit in the car. So we let little kids sit in the car, like. We always love that, and we go to our local car show, our women's club car show at Daniel Boone High School in the spring or the fall or whenever it is. Mm-hmm. But we always let kids crawl around the car, and we just love that aspect of the sport.
Yeah, it's funny because even when I was a track official in the starter stand and stuff back in the time, you know, you see these guys with their helmets and driving suits on, and then you go to the banquet and you go, so that's what he looks like.
Right, yeah.
You know, it's a far cry seeing somebody like you're all, you know, geared up, ready to go, and yeah. then with and without the racing equipment.
I remember I got out of Victory Lane one time, the first time actually, and I took my helmet off and I didn't have a hat on, and like I was like pretty excited, and some lady goes, "Oh my God, he's bald." I was like, "Oh no."
Okay, to end the show. Social media and merchandise, what you got, Kenny?
So our Facebook page is Bock Racing. Go give them a follow. That really helps with showing our sponsors how much traction we get with everything. And merch, we're getting new t-shirts this year. We still have limited t-shirts of last year's, but we're getting new t-shirts from Bob Hilbert.
And oh, I work at Weichel.
Good thing I didn't wear my Bob Hilbert hat.
So it's new t-shirts, and there are some that are left over.
Yep, yep.
So if they do come to the pits after the races, they can possibly get a shirt then.
Yep, and we have hero cards. We actually have double hero card that ATS Alarm Tech made us that have, we did a photo shoot with David Starr, so it has me in my car and David in his car in front of their shop.
Okay. So that was a fantastic April show with Eric Gambler and our special guest, Kenny Bock. I'm looking to get Geezer Finelli, micro driver. He was a late model driver,
a 600 modified
driver, Geezer Finelli. He's now running at Shellhammers on Wednesday nights in a Wingless Wednesday, looking to get him for our May show. So on behalf of Kenny Bock, Eric Gambler, I'm Mike Feltenberger. Thank you and have a good evening.
Cool beans.
Yeah, good show. Very good show.